Okay, let's start. So, welcome to the CDM conference for this year, 2017. So it's a joint conference by MIT and Harvard University each year on the Friday before Thanksgiving. This has been a tradition. So, as usual, this is a good year with many good speakers, and we are expecting to learn a great deal from them. And I'm really happy to see a good turnout. And I turn to, there will be a banquet tonight. And if you're still interested in coming, let Maureen know, and we try to accommodate you. But make sure that if you come, you want to come, you actually come, because we lost money by ordering a banquet with no people show up. So, okay. So I turn the conference to HT, who is going to be chairing this session.
So our first talk is by Professor Nikolai Makarov. He graduated from Leningrad University in 1982, and his main area is harmonic analysis. And so he has a very famous book and called The Gaussian Free Field and Conformal Field Theory. So I strongly recommend you take a look of it. And it's highly related to the talk today. So this is his title, Random Matrices, the Project Growth, and the Conformal Dynamics. Thanks a lot.
Yes. Oh, this one. Thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation. It is my great pleasure and great honor to be speaking here. my talk will be in the area of complex analysis and complex dynamics. In the first part, I will show how methods of rational dynamics can be applied to the theory of equilibrium measure in two-dimensional potential theory, in particular in random normal matrix model. And in the second part of the talk, I will focus on certain dynamics that arises from equilibrium measures. So let me start with reviewing some basic facts concerning droplets. So that's the name for the support of the equilibrium measure, quadrature domains, and Laplacian growth. So part one, this is based on the joint work with Sinyop Lee. He's at Florida right now. so the random normal matrix model is the probability measure on n by n matrices, normal matrices, so a matrix commutes with the conjugate matrix. And this probability measure is given by the partition function, where we consider trace of function of the matrix, and this function Q is called potential function, and it's just a given any given function on the complex plane with values in R and infinity, plus infinity. The only condition is that it's sufficiently large at infinity and lower semi-continuous, in the sense that you can set the function plus infinity everywhere except the real line, and that would be the random Hermitian random matrix model. The focus is on eigenvalues of M, an interpretation is you have n electrons in an external field, n times Q, so we scale like this, and then we get a random measure average of the delta measures at eigenvalues, and it converges to the equilibrium measure. This equilibrium measure can be expressed in terms of a variational problem, Gauss variational problem, so where we want to minimize the energy given by this expression. So the first part of the energy is Coulomb interaction, and then the interaction with the external field. So then we have the following equation for the equilibrium potential, or the potential of the equilibrium measure. It is the sum of the logarithmic potential plus Q, the potential from external field. And the theorem, the statement is that this potential is constant, is equal to gamma, so-called Robin constant, on the droplet. S is the support of the equilibrium measure, and it is greater than this constant, greater or equal than this constant elsewhere. So this is Frostmann's theorem, which is quite clear from physical intuition, because in equilibrium you have no force, so potential has to be constant. And it makes sense to introduce the function this Robin constant minus logarithmic potential. I call this function V. The first line means that V is less than Q. Then the given potential V is equal to potential on the droplet, and it behaves like a logarithm absolute value of Z at infinity. This is because by considering probability measure. This function is subharmonic and harmonic in the complement of the droplet. The droplet means the support of the equilibrium measure.
Is that what S was?
Yes, right. This is a one-dimensional caricature of this problem. It's the obstacle problem that we're considering. The potential. We have a graph of the. Of the given external potential Q, then we are considering V under the graph, so under the obstacle, and we are looking for the minimal subharmonic V under the obstacle such that it behaves, it has slope 1 at infinity in one dimension. And then it looks like this, so we have certain region where the solution to the obstacle problem coincides with the given potential, but this will be the droplet. This is the coincidence set, but essentially this is the droplet. The notation is S of Q, so the support of the equilibrium measure, and a theorem it's a long story, the names Caffarelli, Kinderlehrer, and others, it's free boundary problems. If the external potential is sufficiently smooth in the neighborhood of the droplet, then the equilibrium measure is just the Laplace of Q times indicator function of the coincidence set. So all we need to know is the support of the equilibrium measure. So the density is given by the Laplacian. The most famous case is the potential is absolute value of z squared. So the Laplacian is constant, and the equilibrium measure is a Lebesgue measure essentially on the droplet, and the droplet has to be round by symmetry. So the picture with eigenvalues is the following. Outside of the droplets, so we have exponentially small correlations. So that region is almost frozen. And then this is the density of state, so to say. And then physicists, mathematicians study further terms, so fluctuations around the equilibrium. So in particular, you get the first approximation, the fluctuation would be given by Gaussian free field. So in the non-symmetric case, it's not so easy to find the droplet. It might be very difficult, in fact. But there's a class of potentials we call algebraic or abelian, so which in which case so the problem is integrable, so to say. We'll be considering the following potentials. Is absolute value of z squared minus some harmonic function, and little h is the z derivative of this harmonic function, and algebraicity means that this is a rational function. We'll also call it quadrature function of the external potential. So more generally, one can consider, one can define algebraic potentials as the sum rational function absolute value squared minus, again, harmonic function with derivative rational function. So I will work exclusively with the first case, so we'll be considering absolute value of z squared. I mentioned the more general problem only as an open problem. So most of what I'm will be talking about will has an extension to this more general case, but at this point the theory is not so complete. So I will focus on the potentials when absolute value of z squared minus harmonic function with the derivative rational function. So coincidence equation for such potentials will produce an interesting dynamics in the complement of the droplet, and that's what I will be talking about in the second part. All right, so that was about droplets. Now, Hilish.
H is a rational function,
real value? Real value, it has to be real valued, harmonic function. Little h, let me show you. Okay, so the external potential has to be real, and it cannot be minus infinity, right? So a capital H is a harmonic function, which is real, and little h, it's a z derivative. It is complex now, and it has to be rational function. Now, an important problem is in potential theory is to study the change of the droplet under a change under perturbation of the external potential. So this is how one can approach those fluctuation further terms in the well quantum expansion. I will mention two types of variations. So the first one, we just divide or multiply the external potential by a number. So think of t as time, and we put interpretation, so we're considering t times n electrons in the field n times q. That's the field we're considering previously, but now we introduce a parameter t. So when t is large, then the potential is very weak, cube divided by t, and therefore it won't confine electrons, the droplet will grow to infinity. On the other hand, when t is large, then there's almost, sorry, when t is small, then this the potential is so strong, q divided by t, and t is small, so q divided by t is small, larger, and then it confines the electron to a small domain. So we have a certain evolution of the droplet, the support, not all measure will be considering our probability measures, so we can consider the same obstacle problem with behavior at infinity t times logarithm of z, consider it equilibrium measure sigma t. The support of this measure is exactly the support of q divided by t. One can check this statement. This is the very natural process, growth process for the support of the for the droplets. Another type is when we perturb your potential by adding logarithmic potential at one point vary it. One can consider several such sources, and that's essentially the general case. From several, you can make other sources. The so-called Hilleshoff law. I will explain in what sense. But the most famous example is the case when little h is a linear function. Only constant could be simpler, but in this case, you can add any constant to a potential, nothing will change. So that's the first simplest case, and the family of droplets that we get under this change of potential is the family of concentric ellipses. The next example is the case when little h is z squared. It means that the capital H is a real part of z cube, and that is larger than absolute value of z squared. We don't have the condition at infinity. We need to have a strong field at infinity, otherwise the variational problem doesn't have any solution. All electrons will move to infinity. We need to modify the problem, and we follow physical approach. Here, Wigman and Zabrodin, they discovered or they suggested a certain family of hypertrochoids here as solution to this problem. Which is still is not stated correctly. What's happening here is the following. So we cannot consider this variational problem on the whole plane, but we can localize the problem. So considering parts of the plane and setting potential infinite elsewhere. So sort of building walls or hard edges in this in the model. And the problem becomes transcendental. So there are infinitely many ways to localize the potential, and it's not easy to find all local droplets. The result is that there is only one parameter of family of droplets starting from one point and growing. So these curves are called hypertrochoids. At some point, they reach critical situation, and there are no larger domains. So such droplets are called local droplets, and one can show that an equivalent definition will be the following. So a compact set K is a local droplet for a given potential if Lebesgue measure
is the equilibrium measure of the potential, which is infinite outside of this droplet. In other words, there's nothing on the boundary, everything inside K. And for most algebraic potentials, we need to localize, otherwise the problem doesn't make sense, global sense. And now we use K for notation, K for a droplet. And so the evolution under the change of potential at infinity, so when we multiply potential by a number or divide by t, so this is called Hillishoff law by the name of a British biologist of the 19th century who introduced this. And it is correctly defined backwards. In the backward direction. If we have a local droplet, and then we build the walls outside of the droplet, and consider, so then for every t, for every time less than t0, and t0 is the area of the droplet. So the solution to the variational problem. So with this localized potential is a local droplet. So we have a family of local droplets going backwards. And then this family is a unique solution of the Hillishoff equation. Hillishoff equation is a derivative of the characteristic indicator function of kt is equal to harmonic measure at infinity, at time t. So I have to explain here. Omega sub t at infinity means the value of the harmonic measure. So not the value, the harmonic measure for the domain that we have at time t. And harmonic measure is one of the definition is the heating distribution of the Brownian motion from infinity. The left-hand side is the normal derivative of the boundary, if it makes so if we can interpret it this way. So if we have a smooth family of domains with smooth boundaries, so then this is the normal derivative of the boundary. And we understand this equality against continuous functions. And this is called a Hillishoff equation. It's an interesting topic in itself. It has several important and deep properties. So I only mentioned strong monotonicity. In the forward direction, p means polynomial Hall. So the forward direction, the all points on the exterior boundary of k become interior points at the next moment. And then there are two deep theorems by Sakai. His regularity theorem and his laminarity theorem. Laminarity means that, in algebraic case, for example, there are no topological, infinitely many topological transformations in the droplet in a finite interval of time. Hillishoff law, classical Hillishoff law, is when we have a smooth boundary and it's moving, here it's shown in the forward direction, it's moving with the speed equal to the gradient of the Green function or according to the distribution of harmonic measure from infinity. And this problem is first stated in hydrodynamics, and I repeat, it's an interesting area in itself. So it's the evolution of a less viscous liquid gas, a bubble of gas in a fluid. So then I mentioned another type of perturbations of variations of the potentials when we add a delta logarithmic potential of a delta function somewhere. So one can state, so then this evolution can be described by interior Hillishaw model. So here, the growth of the interior boundary is proportional to the value of to the distribution of harmonic measure at some fixed interior point. So at the point where we insert this delta charge. So in this case, the quadrature function changes, but it changes in a very simple way. So we add one logarithmic kernel. So this picture explains the title of the book by Varchenko and Ettingov, Why the Boundary of a Round Drop Becomes a Curve of Order 4. So it's a very entertaining book. So in particular, so they write that this equation so this precisely this picture came from Polubarinova-Kochina and Kufarev study of the problem of evolution of a round oil spot in water during war times. Okay, and I mentioned Sakai regularity theorem. It says that local droplets can have only a certain type of singularities. So actually, only three type of points are possible of boundary points. So regular boundary points, the droplet is shaded here, so the boundary is so there's no singularity. Then cusp points and cusp of certain types, so conformal cusps, so-called conformal cusps, and double points. So I repeat, shaded area is the droplet. Then there's further classification of cusps, for example, 3/2 cusps, so they're maximal. Once the Hillishaw flow hits a cusp, so so there's nothing, no life behind that. But 5/2 cusps, for example, are not maximal, and then the evolution can go beyond that. All right, so now the last part of this introduction is quadrature domains. So the unit disk has mean value property. If you have an analytic function in the unit disk and integrate it over the disk, say unit disk, so then you need to know only the value of the function at zero, so the mean value property. The converse is also true. If some domain has mean value property, so the integral can be computed from the value of the function at some point, so then this this domain has to be a disk. Surprisingly, so that's relatively well recent theorem. So the difficulty is, of course, to exclude non-simply connected case and. I want to explain what quadrature domain is. So if we integrate a bounded analytic function over a cardioid, and the cardioid is the image of z plus z squared over 2 of the unit disk under this conformal map, so then you can recover the value of f from the value of f at 0 and recover the value of the integral from the value of f at 0 and the derivative of f at 0. So disk and cardioid are quadrature domains. Here's the definition of a quadrature domain that we will use. A domain in the Riemann on the in the complex plane. So we assume that infinity is not on the boundary, so it's either bounded domain or unbounded domain with infinity in the interior. So a domain is a quadrature domain if there exists a Schwarz function. And Schwarz function is a continuous function on the closure of this domain into C hat, Riemann sphere, such that this function is holomorphic holomorphic as a map to C-hat, so it's meromorphic probably, it's a better term. And on the boundary, this function is equal to Z-bar. So let's see how this produces quadrature identities. So integral of f then is the same as contour integral of the boundary of f z bar. Then we replace z bar by the Schwarz function, and then compute the last integral by residues. So we recover so the quadrature domain, so a domain with the Schwarz function can be so there is a rational function with poles in omega, such that for all analytic functions continuous to the boundary, integral of f is equal to the integral of f against this rational function contour integral, which by residue gives a certain formula. So that's the quadrature identity corresponding to a quadrature function. So we distinguish between bounded and unbounded quadrature domains. D is for the number of nodes. D is the degree of the of this rational function. It's called the order of quadrature domain. And n is the number of nodes, the distinct poles of the quadrature functions. So that's the notation. This is how many, d is how many points counting with multiplicity you need to compute the integral of the area. This is the classification of quadrature domains in the lowest dimension. Bounded, so unit disk will be a bounded quadrature domain. And in degree two, we have cardioid, so it has double node at one point, or Neumann's ovals, so is the domain with two distinct nodes. And unbounded quadrature domains in degree zero, it's the exterior of the unit disk, so I shade the complement to the boundary domain. And in degree one, you have exterior of the ellipse, and a whole family of airfoils. So when the for in the case of an ellipse, the node is at infinity, and in case of the wings, you have finite node. All right. So now here's a large source of quadrature domains. They are given by univalent rational functions. If omega is simply connected, then this domain is a quadrature domain if and only if its Riemann map is rational. And I will explain the reason for that. And so there's the following correspondence, one-to-one correspondence. So we go from Riemann maps, which are rational functions, to rational functions that are quadrature identities, and vice versa. In complex analysis, so this transformation is known as Faber transform. So one can actually, given, say, a rational identity, one can find or try to find the Riemann map and vice versa by studying this Faber transform. You get a finite dimensional system of nonlinear equation with several variables. So if you want, so you can call this integrability. So this situation is integrable in the sense Hilly-Schwarz flow is integrable. From the unit disk onto the droplet. I will show. Instead of Schwarz function, we'll rather consider Schwarz reflection. Schwarz reflection is the extension of the local Schwarz reflection. If we have a curve with real analytic boundary, then reflection in this curve, which is an anti-holomorphic involution, and we call it sigma, so it's an involution which is identity on the curve. So we have classical Schwarz reflection principle. It's a local theory. But if we have a Schwarz function, then global Schwarz function, as I defined previously, so a function that is Z-bound, the boundary and meromorphic inside domain. So then this local Schwarz reflection extends to S-bar, and I will use sigma for the Schwarz reflection. And by Sakai theorem, you only if you have a Schwarz function, then the only singularities could be cusps and double points. So most of the time, at most points, the curve is real analytic. So you have local Schwarz reflection, and an interesting case is when this local Schwarz reflection extends to the whole domain. Yes. To Toda flow. Right, so there's a very interesting side of the story concerning integrability and relation to. For example, near the cusps, so the different cusps, so you have KDV hierarchy, but dispersionless. KDV hierarchy, something for double points, probably Toda. This part will not be in my lectures, I am not. But physicists recognize those systems. Yes, it's a difficult to answer. I know the right. Yes, beyond algebraic case, anything seems to be out of reach. You know. Mm-hmm. All right. So let me summarize the properties of the Schwarz reflection. I repeat sigma 4. So this sigma is a hybrid in the sense that near the boundary of the domain, it acts as a reflection, as in reflection groups. But away in the domain, away from the boundary, it behaves like a rational function. And we will see the manifestation of this duality of Schwarz reflection very soon. All right, so here's an explanation why if we have a rational Riemann map, so in this case, so we have two bounded disk and the droplet. So we consider the Riemann map from the outside of the disk to the outside of the. So we assume that the exterior regions are regions quadrature domain. So this is how we prove that it is a quadrature domain. Okay, so we are given that the conformal map is a rational function. So we want to prove that the domain is a quadrature domain. It has Schwarz reflection. So we construct Schwarz reflection. You take any point in the complement, point one, then we use inverse conformal map. So we get point two. Then we make reflection in the circle, we get 0.3, and then we apply the rational function, and we get 0.4. So 4 is the image of 1 under this global Schwarz reflection. Well, and now I want to connect the three pieces of the theory. So the first was equilibrium measure and droplets. The second part of this discussion was Hilshof flows, and the third part was quadrature domains. So if we have a local droplet, then every complementary component has a Schwarz function. And this Schwarz function has the following representation. It's the little h of z in the definition of the equilibrium measure. I call this quadrature function of the external potential, minus Cauchy transform of the equilibrium measure. In our case, it's the Lebesgue measure on the set K. So this is precisely the coincidence equation, comes from coincidence equation. So we have the following equality, equilibrium potential, including the field Q, is constant on the droplet. And the drop and the and potential Q is absolute value of Z squared minus capital H. And then we take Z derivative. And we end up with the equation Z bar minus little h plus Cauchy transform. It's a zero on the domain and therefore on the boundary. And all functions are continuous. Therefore, outside of the boundary, so we get a quadrature, we get Schwarz function. So at infinity, so if the droplet is very small, if k is small, Cauchy transform is almost negligible, then the Schwarz function is essentially our rational function h. But if we go with the Hilleshoff law further, so then the dynamics become less and less rational and becomes a mixture of the dynamics, rational dynamics, and the dynamics of Kleinian groups. So this, we have a combination theorem, which is like Klein's combination theorem. If K is a local droplet of algebraic potential, of an algebraic potential, and little h is the z derivative of capital H, as introduce this. So then this H is the sum of the quadrature functions of quadrature domains, of the components. We represent the complement of the droplet as an disjoint union of the domains and quadrature domains and compute their quadrature function. And the converse is also true. We can construct droplets by considering disjoint unions of quadrature functions. All right, so now I want to show that, so how methods of conformal dynamics could be applied to various questions concerning these three objects. First is topology of the droplets. So here's the classification in the next degrees. Let's look only on on unbounded quadrature domains. So we may have a double pole, and that gives, we'll say, a cardioid inside. So the complement, so we have the cardioid and the exterior disk in the complement of the shaded region. So this shaded region is then a droplet. So now we can apply the Hilleshoff law, and this flow with source at infinity, as I explained, so then we have a strict monotonicity, and then what happens is that so this shaded part, the droplet, splits into two halves, and we will obtain, so under Hilleshoff law, the potential, external potential is not changing, so we have an infinite sequence of integrals of the motion. So what will happen is that we get a quadrature domain of the same of the same quadrature identity, but non-simply connected. It will have two pieces in the complement. So I claim that, so this full classification, you can't have a triply connected quadrature domain in dimension, as I explained. So the second case, when you have two nodes in the quadrature identities, the third picture, and again, the quadrature domain can be doubly connected, but cannot be triply connected. Then we have the case, one node at infinity, so that's the case of the exterior of the ellipse. One node is inside the disks, one finite, same answer. But if we have two nodes at infinity, so the polynomial case, so then the droplet could be only simply connected. And one can give a sharp bounce on the connectivity of the of quadrature domains, and combine this in the description of all possible topologies of droplets. For example, if the degree of the rational function in the definition of an algebraic potential is 4, you can have only this many different configurations. So, of course, so this classification of droplets so only applies to algebraic, real algebraic curves of certain nature. But if one tries to do the same analysis to describe topologies, for example, of in the case when the potential is Z4 rather than Z squared, or any other rational function squared, so that brings certain, then it's, of course, an open question with several interesting cases. All right, and just one word how to use conformal dynamics in the study of droplets or quadrature domains. Let's say we have a non-singular unbounded quadrature domain of order n. The complement, the droplet, is k. And suppose we have Schwarz reflection. Then the Schwarz reflection is over the droplet is a covering map, is a branch cover of degree n plus 1, and over the quadrature domains of it has degree n. And then the claim is that if the droplet has no singular points on the boundary, then we can take the part over omega, ignoring the part over the droplet, and extend it to an n cover. In other words, we cut out n plus 1 cover and replace it by an n cover. And we can do it using methods of quasi-conformal surgery. So in the simplest case, so that's the case when we have a hypertrochoid in the case of the potential absolute value of z squared plus real part of z cubed. We have this region that the next region to the droplet. That would be a three cover, and then if you look at the rest of the picture, then you have a polynomial type map, quadratic type like map, where the droplet serves as infinity. And then the yellow curve is the Julia set of this polynomial type map. And then under this quasi-conformal surgery, we create attracting points in each component. And if we have two components, then by the surgery, we obtain two attracting points, So, but we have only one critical point. Therefore, we arrive to a contradiction that, well, the droplet may have two components. So the methods are the usual straightening methods of Duodier and Hubbard, except that in general so the situation is slightly more complicated than polynomial-like maps, or if you consider rational maps, so then you have to figure out how to do the surgery. Okay, so I have three more examples, but I can skip those examples and finish the first part. Okay, thank you. Okay, so that will be explained. Right. Right. So, I don't know about analysis, but we discussed the question about the topology of the droplet, and of course for analysis that's also important. So if you want to find the droplet, you need to know the topology. So if it's connected, then you use conformal maps and have this Faber equation, so you can solve it. But if it's doubly connected, then you are trying to do something else. Yes, you are right, so it's, so you have Schwartz reflection. So in this method, so you cut out some piece of it, and by surgery you add another piece, and you obtain a rational map. And this rational map has attracting points at each component of the droplet.
When you say attracting point in the sense of the rational map?
No, attracting means precisely locally attracting points. So everything in the neighborhood, dynamics will go there. And then each basin of attraction must have a critical point. And if you have just one critical point, then the topology has to be connected.